foram transformados em líderes de uma nova geração americana. Apesar disso, o título de salvadores da música alternativa é um papel que lhes custa assumir.
I don't understand a lot of the music industry. Like, there's so many bands in the world. There's a million bands in the world. Some of them are really great, some of them are really bad, but there's so many different kinds of bands that it's hard to think of. It's hard to think of us as anything special, you know? I mean, I know that our record came out and we sold a lot of records and people considered us something really special, but it's hard for me to think of something like that because it's hard for me to explain. I don't think that we're the leaders of any musical movement, you know. Sub Pop had a lot to do with the Seattle scene, because after Sub Pop had started putting out records by Mudhoney and Tad and Nirvana, Seattle had its own personality, and I don't think that the rest of the country, nobody knew about Seattle until Sub Pop started selling this personality, you know, and it was an image, you know, it was this weird image of long hair and drunk people with flannel shirts on and people listening to the Stooges, and it was just this weird image that nobody else in the country realized. And once people saw, like, wow, Seattle's kind of cool, then it became, you know, Sub Pop became kind of a big deal. And so it was, you know, it had an incredible influence on what happened to Nirvana. So Sub Pop was like the foundation of everything that happened. Because without Sub Pop, you know, without Sub Pop, there wouldn't be any Mudhoney. And there wouldn't be any, you know, there probably wouldn't be any Nirvana without Sub Pop. When we released the record in September of 1991, and we were on tour, we started touring, and as we were touring America, the record was selling more and more and more, and we were playing these really small clubs, but it started getting crazier and crazier and crazier, to where we would have, you know, 700 people trying to get into a club that fit 150 people, you know, and it just started getting crazy, and we were on tour the whole time. And then we came over to Europe, and our record went to number one in America, and we started selling millions of records, and it was really strange because we didn't really know what was happening. We didn't realize that something big was happening. And then we went and we toured Japan and Australia. So when we came back, all of this crazy shit had happened. We sold 5 million records, and we were all of a sudden, you know, we weren't poor anymore. it was a big difference. Like, all of a sudden we were considered rock stars. They probably expect, you know, they probably expect us to be assholes. They probably expect us to be very arrogant, very obnoxious, and I don't know. I mean, because I don't think people really do consider us rock stars anymore. I mean, not here in Seattle, people don't. You know, in Seattle, if we go to a bar downtown, people just sort of think of you like, oh, there's that guy from Nirvana, and you're just a normal person. So I don't really think people consider us rock stars anymore, just because, you know, I think maybe they realize that we're just normal people, you know? Like, everybody's a person. Like, Madonna. Okay, she's Madonna, wow. But, you know, she shits, and she eats, and she sleeps, and, you know, she's just a normal person. Everybody's a human being. I think that with Nevermind, when we recorded Nevermind, we wanted it to be perfect. With Nevermind, we didn't want any mistakes. We didn't want any flaws. We wanted the record to sound really perfect and really pristine. So with In Utero, we wanted to record the song and not pay attention to perfection. We just wanted to record them the way they sound when we play them. We love the production that Steve Albini did with the Pixies and Jesus Lizard and the Breeders, and he has a really, really great drum sound. And it was the drum sound that we always loved so much. So when we decided to record with him, he didn't like Nirvana. He didn't like our music at all. But he said, okay, well, I'll record you guys and we'll see what happens. So we went in and we did things really, really fast. And he doesn't like to be called a producer because he doesn't produce really, he just records. So that's why it says recorded by, not produced by. But he just did everything really fast, you know. We recorded all the songs in like 4 days and then put all the vocals down and then mixed all the songs. So like it took, I think, 12 days or something, or 13 or 14 days. And we were done. And we were happy at first. And then when we started listening to some songs like Heart-Shaped Box and All Apologies, we thought that they needed to be remixed. And Steve, he didn't want to remix them. He thought that they were the best that they could be. So we decided, okay, well, then we'll ask someone else to remix them. So we called up Scott Litt and asked him to remix some songs, and he did. But there was never any, there was never any pressure from our record label to change anything, because we have, in our contract, we have the final decision. Like, our label can't make us do anything. It was really fun. I was really worried that it was going to suck. I thought it was going to be really terrible, but it turned out pretty good. It was a lot of fun. That was the first time we'd ever really played really quiet. It was really hard for me because I'm used to playing drums really hard, and so it was difficult for me because I had to be so quiet that it was interesting. We liked the way it turned out. It was really great.
Participe. Tocar baixinho não é com eles. E isto fez grande confusão ao baterista dos Nirvana. Suaves não vão ser eles, certamente, no concerto do próximo domingo, no Dramático em Cascais. A primeira data de uma digressão europeia que chama a Portugal jornalistas vindos de toda a Europa. Se tivermos em conta as promessas de Dave Grohl, será um espetáculo a não perder. Ele já está ansioso de cá chegar, nem que seja só para apanhar um bom sol.
It'll be the first one on the tour, which means it'll be the best show of the whole tour. You guys are so lucky. It'll be the best show we've ever played. Write that. Get ready for the best show Nirvana's ever played. I don't know. It should be pretty good. I'm excited. We leave next week. So I'm really excited. It's going to be fun, man. Hey, what's the weather like there now? Hi, this is Dave from Nirvana, and you're listening to Radio Commercial.
Até domingo, então. Dave Grohl, em exclusivo para a Rádio Comercial e para o Semanário Blitz.